pictures of me coming up with my hair all grey and going, fucking hell, fucking hell, fucking hell. What do you think?
We're not gonna bump into shit.
Heather is kind of a gung-ho film student, you know, kind of an alpha personality that is, you know, absolutely committed and driven to making her documentary.
All right, come on, into the house.
My character Josh was very young. I can see you. Not great at dealing with conflict.
And it seems like we're still pretty much on trail.
I've been described as the everyman of the film because I do bring up issues that I feel the audience wants to bring up.
Well, I gotta tell you, I don't fully trust you. And I...
What?
Nothing. I don't know why you have to have every conversation on video, man. Tape some evidence.
Because we're making a documentary.
Not about us getting lost. We're making a documentary about a witch.
The idea for Blair Witch, just basically this documentary crew in the woods, lost, and something kind of haunting them.
Something's just vaguely suggested and never really seen.
Basically, the actor shot the film for us.
Oh, fuck.
We came up with this system of directing the actors by remote control.
They would put down a rock to make sure that at that point, when we passed that rock, we would put the camera on.
We're very, very, very close now.
Ed and I scouted the woods about 3 weeks in advance, and we went to all the different places in the woods where we wanted their campsites to be.
Whoa.
What is this? Dude, guys.
And then we'd have little things waiting for them, actual plot elements in the film.
They're all over the place.
Holy shit.
Our approach to the movie was to have kind of this turning the screws effect as each day goes by.
As the characters run out of food, we start giving the actors less and less food.
Who wants a cheeseburger?
I do.
They wanted us to be hungry and tired.
I have a meatball.
Just one meatball.
And a long red glass of wine.
Yeah.
So they did the sleep deprivation and they stopped feeding us. Which is a really good way to create animosity for future reference.
Put the camera down, this is not funny. This is...
Do I look like I'm laughing at all?
No, but you're going around doing your documentary thing, man.
The dynamic that you're seeing of the characters is very closely related to the dynamic of the actors.
You're still doing your fucking thing.
Don't fuck it!
Then turn the goddamn thing off! If you bite me one more time, I will throw you in the fucking woods.
You touch my camera, we'll
turn
that
thing off!
Again, okay?
Fucking bullshit!
Besides the fact that we wanted to keep them safe, we wanted to push them as far as possible. We told them beforehand, we said, you know, we're going to do some wacky things to you.
We were in the tent, and our sleeping bags were wet. And it had taken us like an hour to get the water in our sleeping bags up to body temperature so we could actually fall asleep in it. And the tent started shaking, and we heard babies crying outside. And so I think all of our first reactions was, I'm not getting up. It's not happening.
Come on, fucking go!
You're waking up out of an extreme tiredness.
Coming.
Your mind isn't quite where it should be.
Oh my God, what the fuck is that? What the fuck is that?
I mean, you can feel the blood pump out of your skin because it's so eerie, the sounds and the noises.
Turn the lights off. Turn the lights off. Turn it off, Josh. You're like, please make it stop.
The last night of the film, Heather's note and my note was to say our goodbyes to our family.
It was a last will and testament, but on videotape of this woman who knows that she's about to die.
Everything had to be my way, and this is where we've ended up.
When she steps down into the basement for the final sort of scene, I was just in there with her. It's just, oh, I can't stand it.
It seems to have gained iconic status, but that objectifies me in a way that I'm not entirely comfortable with.
John Smith's extra smooth.
Does anyone have any tissue?
Shaggy, what are you doing in the corner?
I'm scared, man!
Often in life, you have to rely on your powers of observation. Be able to spot anything out of the ordinary. Now, some of these things will just be completely inexplicable. Whereas others will just be way too big to miss. But the best things are the subtle ones, the ones that work through the power of suggestion.
Levi's had really lost their way. No one was wearing Levi's.
I'm mad about the boy.
Jeans weren't doing particularly well because they'd gone through the whole combat trousers thing.
Combat trousers are replacing jeans.
You be mad about the boy.
Throw jeans out.
I'm so ashamed of it.
But the brand had been associated with a historical setting, a boy meets girl, and a great music track.
About the boy.
Up pops a yellow puppet. The rest is history.
By some fluke, this short film of a French director arrived on the desk of the ad agency creatives. It had this little kind of gopher puppet in it.
Stéphane and Philippe traveled around in a car in the countryside of France doing these sort of fairly bizarre things. And you went, what's happening here?
And they thought, we could make this into something big.
What we tried to do was give his facial features more definition. Stéphane originally had quite a round head. We cut the top of his head off. Flat Eric, he has no ears and has this little kind of quiff at the front, which is slightly reminiscent of a skinhead.
Just came at a time when there wasn't much silliness.
Complicated black and white photography and your horses in tidal waves, it's just, you just want a little ambiguous puppet.
Flat Eric seems to me to be this complete oxymoron, or contradiction in terms, if you like.
He was very cute, yet very cool.
Anything that's soft and cuddly is endearing. But the situations he was in made him cool.
The interesting thing about him was his relationship with this guy, this kind of cool guy who obviously the puppet controlled. And the puppet seemed very in charge in that relationship.
He never kind of found out what they were wanted for, and he was such a lovable creature that you thought, God, they can't want him for anything.
Everybody here. I mean, they were constructed to be a road movie.
Mind stepping out of the car, sir?
There isn't a beginning, middle, and an end to this story. You just observe a moment in time. You're not quite sure whether they're dead or whether they're alive. And you're not quite sure whether they're wanted by the police or not. You're not quite sure what their relationship is between one another. There are almost so many question marks that that's the reason that the consumer likes it, because we haven't fed the answer to them on a plate.
Nobody could really work out what he was or what he was meant to be.
Was it supposed to be an animal? What animal was it?
Don't know, doesn't matter. We don't have to tell you what he is. It's Flat Eric.
A Muppet. You know, it's an offcut from the bottom of one of the Muppet puppets that escaped and went to France.
You have the physical texture, say, of Fozzie Bear.
the sort of wit of Kermit. But he has animals kind of gesture of nodding. I mean, it's very usual by them for Jean's ads to spawn a number one record, but this was quite an unusual number one, because not only did it not have any vocals, it didn't even really have a tune.
He's short, yellow and furry, and his record's gone straight in at number one.
He kept Eminem off the number one spot. Who broke the news to Eminem? Who told him that? You're not number one. Why? Who is?
Wow.
Flat Erics were everywhere. There was Flat Eric teddy bears and puppets in people's car windows.
When we put him on the front of Heat, it was the biggest selling issue of the whole year.
Chris Miles like put it on a radio one once and went, right, I'm putting it on. Everyone rush to the window and have a look in the cars, see how many people are sat there doing it.
Well, some would look at me aghast, say, what is that idiot looking at? This is Flat Eric, look, son. The five-year-old boy, totally unimpressed. I'm still laughing. I can't not laugh at the thought of Flat Eric.
If there's one thing we learned in the 90s, it was the art of first thing in the morning. It wasn't when you woke up or how you woke up. It was who you woke up with.
By God, she is gorgeous, isn't she?
I've met Kelly Brook in person. And she just looks as good as she does in her picture. She's a lovely girl.
I wish that I could fly.
When I started going out and about, and it was kind of when the Loud Mag thing started as well, with Maxim and FHM and that. So I kind of got away in there. My first cover of a magazine when they hailed me as the new Cindy Crawford.
Classic about her. She never gets the kit right off. It's always that tease thing. And then she was Nikki with the tiki.
Challenge, Shaw for men.
The Shaw ad was just someone to get the guy all hot in the car so he needs some deodorant and stuff. And we went to Spain for a week and filmed it, and it was brilliant. They gave me some advice, you know, if I was going to get into the industry, mainly to stay away from Mick Hucknall. Which I thought was quite funny. I didn't know what he was talking about at the time, but now I know.
I remember I did a show and they said, we're going to get this new Raven reporter. She hadn't been singing before, but she's, well, she has been singing, but she's never done any presenting before.
Granada phoned my agent and said, you know, we're doing this show called VPL, and it's basically a fashion show, and we'd like a model to front it and interview models and designers and, you know, and just talk about the industry. So I thought, well, that sounds cool.
I'm a film.
Everybody always
lovely.
Says that.
Is that your natural hair colour?
One night, Johnny Vaughan and his wife Antonia were watching the television and my show come on.
Hello, today I'm in a Soho hair salon. This is no ordinary hair salon.
I'd met Johnny previously because I'd worked with Antonia in New York, and Johnny was like, oh, I didn't know that she, you know, she did presenting, and Antonia said, neither did I.
What first gave you the idea of pubic wigs?
And Johnny said, well, yeah, Denise is leaving, why don't we get her in and have an audition? And all the love
I have is expressed. Sounds easy.
But Kelly was auditioning to replace the queen of Breakfast TV, half of a truly golden couple.
Denise and Johnny had become one of those classic showbiz combos where you can't envisage anybody else ever breaking that special chemistry and magnetism that the couple had.
I think whoever took over from Denise would have had a really, really hard time of it. I think Big Breakfast was already getting quite tired as a formula, and the viewing figures were already going down.
It gets press coverage totally out of proportion to the sort of audience that it draws.
And then I remembered seeing a list of girls, and they had odds on who was going to get the job. It was like the most sought-after job on television. You know, all these people that have been around a while, I mean, who's Kelly Brook?
Let's put Kelly Brook on the television. She's very pretty, she's got big boobs, and men are going to love her.
My mum was aware, because of the press coverage it was getting, that, you know, you've landed a big job here. You should be very scared.
I just remember thinking, she's got all the things that everybody wants at the moment, which are two good looks and a fair set of boobs.
And I was like, oh, Mum, you know, I'm just going to go in there and be myself and it's all going to be fine.
Welcome to The Big Breakfast. It's Wednesday, 24th February. I'm Johnny Vaughan.
Yay!
And I'm Kelly Brook.
Oh, yes! Morning, Kel.
Morning, John. I felt a little bit under pressure that I didn't want to kind of talk over him.
OK, thank you very much, Sue.
You know, he's a very clever guy. I mean, he's like, he's a lot older than me and he knows a lot more than me.
37% of men leave their wives because of her adultery.
No. So I felt a little bit intimidated by that.
It's like ice cream though, isn't it? Like, you might like one flavour, but you just want to try some others to make sure you do like that flavour.
Kelly Brook, you are wonderfully modern, but I am out of the old school.
The capricious Johnny Vaughan is hugely talented, but very difficult to present next to, because he's so ebullient, he's so vociferous, he's so spontaneous. You know, what does it leave you doing, sitting there looking like a complete spare part?
Yeah, we've got loads and loads of fantastic guests on this week's show.
We certainly have.
Joel Schumacher
coming. We saw his film yesterday.
Robert, go on, say surname.
Kelly was literally dragged from nowhere. And stuck next to probably one of the smartest, sharpest guys in television.
And everybody was just waiting for her to slip up.
All she was going to do, in my view, was fail.
OK, now, yesterday we launched GYMTV.
Oh, we did.
Basically, we launched it at the Spirit Health and Fitness Club in Cambridge. They are our focus group. They're there to give their opinions on items in the show.
They had to spell out phonetically the words that she had to say.
We've got a 16-year-old runner that's totally under pressure and has got 2 minutes to write down what's coming up after the break. Well, after the break, we've got young fogey Kelly Reid in the house. You know, so she's scribbling down someone's name and what I'm going to be talking to them about and holds it under the camera.
You can see her eyes moving along the cue cards.
I'm not looking at it thinking, what does that say? And an exclusive interview with Mel C and Gianluca Vialli. Am I saying that right?
There were certain items, for example, vital statistics.
Vital statistics, eats haddock and kippers. Vital statistics, dumps in your slippers.
It asked you three questions. One of them would be...
The number of nappies the average four-month-old child will get through in a week. The number of nappies the average four-month-old child will get through in a week.
You know, who cares what you say? You're going to get it wrong anyway.
30,000.
OK.
You know, he'd ask a ridiculous question, would throw ridiculous answers back.
Occasionally, she'd venture some kind of opinion and be shot down in flames by the crew, looking completely appalled that she'd even opened her mouth.
Wait a week.
One baby.
I thought you meant as in the whole...
No.
I mean, she was only young, what, 19 when she got that gig? 19.
People go, oh my God, I can't honestly believe she thinks 25,000 nappies a baby gets through a week.
Go on, what do you reckon?
Oh, one baby, okay, about 50.
The average, it's 42, ladies and gentlemen.
The biggest tragedy in the Kelly Brook situation was that she was working on Channel 4 breakfast television instead of Channel 3 breakfast television with me.
They were so cowardly about it, they did it while she was away on holiday.
I was in Gran Canaria and I'm lying on the beach and I said, yeah, I'm just going to go to the shop and get some ice cream. So I've walked over to the shop and I've looked down and I've seen TV Kelly axed. And I thought, oh my God, that's me. Got into my hotel room, phoned my mum. She said, you know what, Kelly, even if it's not true, even if you still have got your job, she went, don't go back there. She went, they're just a bunch of arseholes. She went, you don't need it.
I think it's the best thing that ever happened to her, actually. I think it's sort of helped to get on with things.
The bit that brings a smile to my face is that Kelly Brook's career since she left The Big Breakfast has gone like that. Well, the fortunes of The Big Breakfast have gone down like that.
I still think she's got a fab pair of tits, so it doesn't matter, and I'm sure she'll go very far with them.
Tastes like cough medicine.
Really does quite honestly smell like
it ought to be coming out of a chimney in port sunlight.
You're right.
I don't know anything about the ingredients of the drink at all, but you certainly get quite a few people
raising their eyebrows at each other as to whether it's entirely legal.
Don't actually care what's in it unless you're going to tell me that there's something really bad in it.
Should I be aware of what's in it? I don't know. Should I be scared?
Taurine? What's taurine?
Bull's testicles.
Yeah, why is it called Red Bull? You've got me worried now.
Cretin Dang means the Red Bull. There's a story about a so-called never-resting bull running around the forest in the north of Thailand, and he's sort of like the symbol for endless energy.
It was an idea that was imported from Thailand. The guy who set up the company actually found this energy drink that was used by tuk-tuk drivers.
Their mad taxi drivers drink it so that they can work all through the night and then all day the next day. In fact, I don't think they ever sleep.
It wasn't sure what it wanted to be. It wanted to be an energy drink, but consumers weren't used to energy drinks because all they knew was Lucozade.
The equivalent of that, for me, when I was a student, was Pro Plus tablets, you know, which you'd have to take about 30 of in order to stay awake for an extra hour. Whereas now, you could just have one Red Bull and you're awake for a week, definitely.
They would put TV campaigns on in the middle of the night.
There was one where this bird does a poo on this guy. He then takes a swig of some Red Bull, it gives him wings, and then it flies up, and he gets above the bird, and the end of this advert is when he just undoes his fly as if he was going to have a go on the bird himself.
Was it? Red Bull gives you wings. Now, to me, that implies that my underpants are going to start looking like I'm wearing some kind of feminine hygiene product.
They'd done one or two attempts at trying to market it as an energy drink, and it hadn't really taken off, but it just started to acquire this sort of fairly irreverent image among people like students and clubbers. And then they said, well, that's where our market is, let's go after that.
By the end of 1999, Red Bull was outselling Cork in single can sales.
Well, I'm a friend of the Bull, apparently. Don't get much sleep. Work very, very hard. How many a night would I drink? Scared to say.
I actually always thought it was like some kind of smokescreen, you know. Let's say we're drinking Red Bull, but really we're taking ecstasy.
Hey, a lot of kids take E's, which I will not condone at all. And if you've never taken an E in your life, try Red Bull. Try five. It'll get you as wide as an E, I suppose so.
I would say no more than three cans a night. It depends what kind of effect you want to have. If you want to lose your grip on reality, then by all means, five or six.
There are a lot of people walking around at one time, just like this. And then other people walking around like this, going, I haven't slept, I can't sleep, I've not slept for 4 days. I've got Red Bull.
And if you mix it with vodka, it's a whole nother effect.
A little bit of a sort of, you know, how many Red Bull and vodkas do you have? About four, why?
It's almost like mainlining alcohol if you had a vodka Red Bull. But they think, you know, they're really, whoa! And you go, nothing's happened at all. You're still telling that boring story you told me last time you were drunk.
It costs a lot, I have to say.
I don't think any mixer should exceed the price of the spirits that are going in the glass. You know what I mean? You just knew that relationships weren't going to last when you met a girl and she went, I'll have a vodka and Red Bull.
So we're going to make a music video, right? And we're going to have dancers that can't dance. And we're going to have a choreographer who can't choreograph. And you're going to shoot it. And we're just going to shoot it. Wherever the car runs out of gas, people are gonna love it.
For anyone who hasn't ever seen the Praise You video, it's basically six people who look like chumps, the kind of losers that you always avoided in school.
Richard put down the boombox, he hit it, and we started to dance.
We had unique moves, things that weren't normally seen.
And magic happened.
They are a genuine group, aren't they?
Did they think their moves were really cool, or did they know they were being silly? That's the question.
The main guy behind the video is a guy called Spike Jones. He's so annoying because he's a photographer, actor, director, bloomin' video maker.
You have something inside you which is unique, and it's your job as a director to follow that. And Spike's thing is he loves to come up with these wacky ideas.
Norman Cook tells the story that he originally had this rough idea after having had a chat with Spike Jones. Can you imagine pitching this to a record company? Yeah, we've got this idea, we're going to get six complete losers to dance like imbeciles.
In some really bad clothes, very badly shot on video cameras outside of a movie theatre in Pasadena or wherever it is.
And what's really sad about this is loads and loads of people bought into this and thought they were for real.
For the video, Spike Jones and his troupe of actors went into character as choreographer Richard Coffey in the entirely fictional Torrance Community Dance Group.
Sometimes there's energy and like something that, you know, just like playing off of each other.
The dance moves he creates are amazing.
You know, it's like great stand-up comedians working off of each other.
Aside from that, the guy is just a really nice guy.
Some of us met at church.
Just really down to earth, and he's just got a good heart.
The streets are as much for dance as they are for anything else.
I am just thrilled that he let me into the group.
It's all this choreography also, let me tell you. Original stuff.
The night we recorded Crazy, we happened to be out in front of a movie theater. There were lines of people getting ready to buy tickets for the movies.
And people wandering past, looking at them, going, what are you doing?
It was something we did one time, and what you see was shot with one take, period.
I have to praise you like I should.
The most brilliantly crap moves.
It reminds you of like when you were a kid and you used to do like PE. Trees.
We were coming up with original steps. I mean, so original that people just could not accept how original they were. Oh my God, I feel a pony coming on. This feels like a pony step. So we'd start naming the steps. Fish, to the other side, we do the fish.
We would jump with our arms flying out, and that was called the Julie Andrews.
The hills are alive.
I don't know why.
Teapot.
We had a hand here and we did a little teapot. And then we had the airplane, our arms straight out and just flying around.
We were right in the middle of the best part of the dance. And one of the employees from the theater decided that we shouldn't be dancing on his property.
So I stopped the CD, I turned around, and I saw him coming towards me. And I thought, well, this is LA. If you put your arms around him, you might get sued for sexual harassment or something. So I just folded the arms in front of me, and he leapt on me like a monkey.
He jumped on him and did the bug step. So the guy didn't even know that he was part of our performance. It was genius.
Well, 10 minutes of fame, as they say, I suppose.
It's starting to get with the b-boy, you guys. It's Fat Boy Slim.
We were blown away. It became a hit, and Torrance Community Dancers nominated for 4 MTV Awards.
Thanks very much. But we got praised. I mean, the song's called I Wanna Praise You Like I Should. So we got praised with all those awards, so it all made sense.
Hello? Hello? Hello.
'99 was the zenith of the sort of the glossy magazine photo shoot as far as weddings were concerned.
I'm very happy to look at celebrity wedding photos because I'll look at anybody's wedding photos. I'm just nosy. So when it all became a huge thing that celebrities would let you see their wedding because they'll get millions of pounds, then you go, oh, fabulous, I'll look.
And first in the restricted access tunnel of love, Major and Noble, the principal boy and the showgirl.
When a magazine buys up a wedding or an event, it does become a bit of a nightmare. But you've got to get a picture that your readers want to see.
They couldn't afford to get married in a big estate with lots of private land around that they could keep the press out. They got married somewhere far more public.
Hello magazine obviously had to take huge security measures just because they were so worried about the exclusive appearing in the papers.
Emma!
You had these big screens being carried by bouncers to stop any paparazzi taking pictures. What should have been a happy day becomes so sort of interfered with by the magazine that I think people just became turned off by it in the end.
And that became the story. What a disastrous way of conducting a marriage and a wedding.
Next, by royal appointment, they had quite a lot of flags. They had a coach of sorts. They did have the castle, but there are some things royalty just can't buy.
With Edward and Sophie, we were dealing with two people who clearly would much rather the press hadn't been invited.
What a damp squib it was. It was dire. Hardly anyone watched it. Edward looked completely bemused and bewildered. The bachelor prince, famed for being a bachelor, nobody seemed to be awfully convinced by him suddenly becoming a married bachelor prince.
They didn't seem to realise that it was a wedding day. People can smile. It was so wooden.
Everybody wanted them to come out on top of the steps and do the kiss. It didn't happen. We just didn't get the kiss.
There's not one lasting image from Edward and Sophie's wedding. It was like a very poor dress rehearsal.
And so Edward and Sophie made way for the real royal wedding of the year.
Manchester United's David Beckham and posh spice Victoria Adams tied the knot this afternoon at Lochilstown Castle near Dublin.
Every single detail about that wedding would be splashed across the newspapers. The wedding cake, the invitation.
Their outfit, Brooklyn, the cake with little Brooklyn on.
There were definitely going to be crowns, if possible coaches. Certainly billowing gowns.
Every time a little bit leaked out in the papers, everyone I knew was on the phone talking about it, emailing each other, have you heard this bit, have you heard that bit?
In offices around London, sort of nationwide, all people were gossiping about, what's her dress going to be like? What's he going to wear? Is he going to look an idiot?
Posh and Beck's wedding, everyone knew it was going to OK Magazine, and everyone knew OK Magazine would pay big bucks, £1 million for it.
The Sun and the Mirror would do anything to get a photo that they'd pay huge amounts of money.
The gauntlet had been thrown down. Come on, Fleet Street, see if you can bust apart this wedding.
They tried to approach waiters, tried to approach musicians.
One guy spent days and nights lying in a ditch underneath a piece of rotting wood.
One enterprising Australian photographer got himself into the grounds over here 6 days ago.
And was still within sniffing distance of the wedding until 20 minutes, I think 20 minutes before the service began.
But a tracker dog found him out today.
And the really, really stupid money was when we hired a helicopter to go and see what they could get. And two other helicopters simultaneously arose from the grounds of this estate as our helicopter went over and started buzzing it. And the net result, we didn't get anything at all.
I was very pleased when the Sun came out with these grainy shots of Posh and Beck's on their ridiculous thrones.
I don't know who took the pictures. I know who sold them to us at the Sun, but I do not know who actually pressed the shutter.
After all the security arrangements they'd gone to, they still managed to get these fantastic shots out and scupper the whole deal. Fantastic.
The Mirror did well out of it because when the Sun printed the first edition with these pictures in, we just stole them, photocopied them and stuck them in the Mirror.
The wedding was based around a Robin Hood theme. For example, in Victoria's bouquet, she decided to have sort of apples and twigs and leaves. She was wearing on her crown. She decided not to wear a veil, a traditional veil.
They changed from their wedding outfits and then put on their purple outfits. They were matching outfits. That was fantastic.
I am a very stylish girl.
The whole royal thing continued when, at the wedding breakfast, they decided to sit on those huge throne things. Forget having your family around the top table, but because nobody else is really important, just them.
Victoria likes to have a sort of little bit of fun, so she wanted to be sort of this big joke. Oh, I want to sit on my throne. What will they say?
They say it was ironic, but I think it was deadly serious. We're not talking toilets here, we're talking about full-on gold, plush, velvet-lined thrones.
Something you'd see in a Tsar's palace. I don't think it's the sort of thing you'd find in Habitat or IKEA.
I must say I'm amazed.
At about 4 o'clock in the morning, Victoria and David came down in their white toweling dressing gowns and sat picking out the photos that they did and didn't want.
Stylish girl.
If this is supposed to be the day you're pledging to be in love with each other forever, why have you got to spend the night looking at proofs of okay pictures?
How do I look?
But I think they added hugely to the gaiety of nations. I loved reading it. It was just endlessly fascinating. You don't really know why you're looking at it, but you just can't stop yourself. So I was hugely grateful to them for bothering to take the time to have so many pictures taken.
There's some stuff that happens all over the world every day, and we don't talk about it because it's either too embarrassing or too scary or too weird. And in 99, it came out and hit us right in the face.
The story is about two 29-year-old men, Stu and Vince, best friends, and then their lives are turned upside down when a 15-year-old boy, Nathan Maloney, bursts out the closet and wedges himself into their lives.
Got somewhere to go?
No.
When I come back to mine.
It opened with this fantastically graphic sex scene.
There's two guys kissing, properly kissing, actually having sex on television. In bed with a 15-year-old boy. Ah! I can't believe he's doing this.
No one told you about that, did they?
I was ringing all my friends again. Oh, you've got to watch this, got to watch this.
Sit. Slowly.
And you just thought, my God, I can't believe they're allowed to show this. I've seen porn movies that are less graphic than this.
The sex scenes were put up front only because that's when the story started. Because the moment Stuart fucked Nathan, then Nathan's mind was fucked. That's where the story started.
It was actually the first time on British television that anyone had dared depict that moment, the kind of ejaculation moment.
One day on the prop list, it said, one, spunk, brackets, to be edible.
So what do you like doing?
We had face cream mixed with loads of other products that we could find in the makeup bag to make up the right substance.
Oh, you can almost smell it in the room.
Yeah.
And we put that on the actor's hand.
I see you, baby.
Jesus Christ, do you have to?
And filmed a few close-ups where it
flicks.
No, it's just some bloke.
What they miss from that scene dramatically is it's not ejaculation, it's premature ejaculation.
Right, well, thanks for that. Gotta go.
In Nathan's mind, to come too soon, it's the worst thing that can possibly happen, which then sets in motion a whole 10 hours of story, because he's forever trying to make up to Stuart the fact that, in his mind, he got it wrong.
Hey. Oh, you didn't expect that with your cornflakes, did you?
The moral outrage from Middle England was absolutely expected. We knew that was coming.
I thought it was lowering, depressing, coarse, crude, amoral, and frankly incoherent.
We did a press screening, and which was packed, and at the end of it people clapped, and one lady put her hand up and said, listen, I'm from the Daily Mail, I thought that was absolutely fantastic, I really enjoyed it, but you do understand I'm going to have to write an article tomorrow slagging it off.
Because my mum told me, Dad, and he was furious. He was shouting, he said, get out! He called me a puff and he threw me out the house!
The fact is that our children's sexuality is waking up at any time.
I'll go to London. I'll go tonight. I'll live on the streets. I'll be a red boy and I'll be murdered. I will!
So Hazel takes Nathan in.
You know you're getting older when the drama queens start looking younger.
Nathan's the new boy on the block and his mum is having to come to terms.
Come out for a drink, it's allowed, isn't it?
I was just telling your mother. Best day of my life. My son came out, I find all this.
They tried to hate it for a little while, but then they realised that they couldn't because it had actually changed something. A programme like that goes on air and it just changes the zeitgeist because it's so strong.
Call me baby.
the big black Jeep that Stuart drove round in. It was like a tank. It was like this gay warrior in this black tank.
Just a big, shiny basket. All the girlies say I'm pretty fly for a white guy. I wrote up Jeepy because on Biker Grove, they did the first ever gay teenager.
Are you girls trying to chop me up?
You're not?
Uh-huh. Raven.
At the end of that story, Noddy, I think his name was Noddy, drove off happily with a boyfriend in a Jeep. Our props people went along to a company in Manchester that sold black Jeeps. And the Jeep people said to our props people, I said, oh, yeah, no, those black Jeeps. It said, actually, we get a lot of gay guys buying them.
The thing about those lads, money to burn, and then they die young, so we get the resale value. Take it for a spin and sign this when you get back.
And I was like, right, you bastards, I am getting you for that.
And the brilliant thing about Stuart is he does what you always wanted to do.
I'll take it.
Where do I sign?
Cool guy.
Every bit of violence, physical violence, was all directed at the Jeep. Never had the cliche of a gay man being beaten up.
It's my dad!
Nath, get in that house. He's 15 years old. He's 15. That boy is 15.
That scene has my favourite line in the whole series.
The Jeep's only 6 months old and you've still buggered it.
You bastard.
And he gets queers written down the side of his Jeep. And not only is he happy to drive through the streets with that written on the side of his Jeep, but he'll drive into a school.
He drove his schoolboy boyfriend right up to the school gates, swept in front of the school, in front of all these other kids.
Imagine, he's just slept with a 15-year-old boy, and then he drives him to school.
That isn't a piece of graffiti, it's like a statement that he's proud of.
Come on, boys, give us a kiss.
I'll give you a good fuck, you tight little virgin. You won't be laughing then.
He would not go and get that Jeep painted over straight away, because...
It said more about his character in that moment than anything else could possibly have done.
You can't miss me.
What was new to people, I think, was the gay world putting such real, big, bold colours on screen.
Let me give you some advice. Choose your friends carefully. You may need them someday. And learn to read a map. You never know when it'll come in handy. Don't imagine woods to be romantic. They're full of ticks and shrill actors. But don't listen to me. Listen to Baz.
Wear sunscreen. If I could offer you only one tip for the future, sunscreen would be it.
The thing about sunscreen when it came out, a lot of people didn't realize, was that it was by Baz Luhrmann, the guy who did Strictly Ballroom, Romeo and Juliet, and more recently Moulin Rouge. I think everybody should have a copy of this record, because this guy's a genius.
We had this major film coming up that was a musical in form, Moulin Rouge. And so, you know, what I really wanted to do is get more involved in hands-on music producing. And we'd done this kind of remix of a very well-known dance hit from the 1980s, Rosella, Everybody's Free. Yeah, everybody's free.
Oh, yeah, yeah. I wrote a column in the Chicago Tribune with little bits of advice to people graduating from school. All of a sudden, someone posted it on the internet. It was being read by millions of people around the world.
My music producing partner, Anton Monstedt, came to me and said, look, my best friend sent me this great speech. And I immediately read these, what seemed to me to be incredible insights.
And Baz said, this is perfect. We have to record it immediately.
I got a call saying, Mary, my name is Baz Luhrmann. I have an idea for the material. Well, this is such a movie way to put it, an idea for the material.
Not a day later, we hired a voice.
Ladies and gentlemen of the class of 99.
I'm a voiceover artist in Sydney, and I go from studio to studio providing character voices for things.
Wear sunscreen.
It's the sound of a man who has lived.
If I could offer you only one tip for the future.
I remember you sort of stopped and you really wanted to listen to what we had to say.
Sunscreen would be it.
People have said to me, oh, don't you wish you could have spoken that? I've always said no. People would not have listened to me.
Enjoy the power and beauty of your youth. In 20 years, you look back at photos of yourself and recall in a way you can't grasp now how much possibility lay before you and how fabulous you really looked.
So your answer will share and buy it because it would just invade your brain with its beautiful advice.
Don't worry about the future, or worry, but know that worrying is as effective as trying to solve an algebra equation by chewing bubblegum.
It was really positive, but very strange.
The real troubles in your life are apt to be things that never crossed your worried mind, the kind that blindsides you at 4 p.m. on some idle Tuesday.
All of a sudden, along came a record, which was a bit like the sort of advice you'd expect from your grandparents.
Don't be reckless with other people's hearts. Don't put up with people who are reckless with yours. Floss.
And you can see them thinking, yeah, what am I all freaked out about?
I'm sure there was supposed to be a point to it all, but I don't know what it was.
It's a prayer. That's the truth. It's a little prayer, you know, or a little mantra.
Remember compliments you receive. Forget the insult. If you succeed in doing this, tell me how.
We didn't quite know how to present it. Do I sit there with a pipe and slippers and a smoking jacket, or you know, in a rocking chair, or do I stand behind a lectern?
Enjoy your body. Use it every way you can. Don't be afraid of it or what other people think of it. It's the greatest instrument you'll ever own.
Use all this.
Get plenty of cash. Oh. Be kind to your knees. You'll miss them when they're gone.
The sort of thing Jerry Halliwell would love.
You are not as fat as you imagine.
But if you're Ann Widdicombe, you are as fat as you imagine.
Maybe you'll marry. Maybe you won't. Maybe you'll have children. Maybe you won't. Maybe you'll divorce at 40. Maybe you'll dance the funky chicken on your 75th wedding anniversary.
People hear it and think it's almost embarrassingly cheesy.
The idea is the silliness that disarms you so that you can actually feel the direct emotional value.
Be nice to your siblings. They're your best link to your past and the people most likely to stick with you in the future.
There is probably a little postscript to this story in that I feel I can talk about it now, is that at the time my father was dying of skin cancer, and I did really hope that it threw some focus on this issue in the country.
You get to know your parents. You never know when they'll be gone for good.
I can't tell you how many people have told me that when they heard that line, get to know your parents, you never know when they'll be gone for good, they picked up the phone and called their parents.